I used to actually be terrified in any water where I couldn't see the bottom. Inky black water. Tales of monsters lurking in the deep. That absolutely terrified me. Then sort of sharks came along to my mind through various things like Jaws and documentaries. That just fueled fascination. What are these enigmatic, crazy creatures? They were just sort of mind-blowingly awesome. The thing that drove me on this path was a pure passion for the animals themselves. You know, I didn't start out wanting to save them because I didn't know that they needed saving or help. Some form of sharks and rays existed before trees, and we know, like, astonishingly little. They've been lurking in the depths of our oceans for in excess of 400 million years, and they've been part of the stability of that ocean. The stability is in flux, it changes, but it ends up being functional and stable. And sharks are a massive part of that.
I swear that you've seen me. Yes, you've seen me here before. Before. And so don't tell it. Don't tell it otherwise. This voice. This particular voice, yes, you've heard it before.
I couldn't even imagine as a kid, enthralled with sharks, poring through books, even being in a position where I'm actually somehow going out each day and interacting with these animals. Save Our Seas Foundation was just starting out. So I applied and found myself in the Red Sea in 2007. This massive juxtaposition of huge, expansive deserts and then massively abundant marine life right on its doorstep. On a good day, it's still some of the best diving I've ever experienced anywhere in the world. You could be on an offshore reef where you start getting some of these sort of open ocean species coming in, and you could have all the reef sharks, like grey reefs and silver tips, massive big grouper. You could have swarms of hundreds of barracuda coming around that. And then if you're lucky, you have squalling hammerheads coming past, and then tiger sharks chilling out on the edges, and then the silky sharks everywhere. Silky sharks. They're pretty special. They look very much like your generic shark. But what really sort of makes them so charismatic is their behavior. They're sort of really, really curious. And they have to come out and check you out. For me, this was a completely new experience. Suddenly you're having these interactions with these animals. So when you dive somewhere so regularly, they're not just faceless, nameless sharks, but actually, you know, that one's Bricktop, that one's Jemima, you know, this one coming by is Blinky and Stumpy and Spotty, and you get to know them. You you learn their behaviors and you know that, you know, this shark is particularly bold, that one's particularly sneaky, that one's always super skittish and nervy unless that one's here, and then they come in together. They're one of the most heavily exploited sharks around the world, but one of the least studied, whereas we had access to them within, you know, 10 miles of the coast. That probably was the first Save Our Seas Foundation project. And I was, yeah, essentially a research technician. I was helping with all the equipment that you needed to try and find out where these sharks go, because we didn't know anything. There was a real strong local fishery for the sharks, which, you know, we have been noticing declines in certain areas. And when you go back and look at that, sometimes almost daily data we were collecting of how many we're seeing and things, you can see for the silky sharks, it was quite a gradual, but there's this long-term, over a decade decline, which when you're going out every day, you don't notice quite so much, you know. It's a bit of a shifting baseline experience, you know. You, over time, sort of habituate to the number you're seeing. You go there one day and Bricktop's not there, or Jemima hasn't shown up, or, you know. And you think, oh, well, they've probably just gone off somewhere else for a while, you know, things change, and then they don't come back, and then more don't come back, and you find yourself sort of changing from going to jump in, expecting to see, you know, everyone, to actually wondering if you'll see anyone. And that is heartbreaking. And at that point, really, the only place we could find them was the fish market. So we then have to go and rummage through these piles of fins and things, wondering if you knew any of these animals. So the impact of seeing and experiencing that is, I think, quite severe. I actually think it's very hard to know just how much you love something until you lose it. Grief is the price we pay for love. The first recognizable ancestors of sharks existed before trees, whereas now, you know, in the space of 50 to 60 years, they could be, you know, facing collapse in a single generation. It's a very stark realization. At times, it can be quite overwhelming and disheartening to think, well, how can you do anything about this at all? But it was around that time that Save Our Seas also started to ramp up and grow. My skill set that I had at that time was a scientific background. I'm going to help provide data. I'm going to try and find things out. I'm going to hopefully provide useful information that we need on these animals so that decisions can be made that make sure this kind of thing doesn't happen again. That's when I really sort of got to travel a bit more and go to these places. Cocos Islands, Bahamas, the Galapagos Islands, Maldives, Cape Town. But it gives you hope that places like this exist. I realized that if we want to help save sharks, we need to make sure they have safe places to live in. So coming to Daros, especially the first time, it's pretty hard to put into words. You're surrounded by this abundance and diversity of life, and this sort of really small speck of a spot on the planet. Almost, a bit like a marine Jurassic Park. You can stand on the beach, have turtles nesting in the daytime, have some giant tortoises chilling somewhere behind you, crabs scuttling everywhere, massive frigibirds that soar overhead and cast shadows that look like pterodactyls. You can literally walk off the beach and you'll have little black tits swing past, you'll have mantas feeding in a train, sharks and rays and turtles. And in some places, they're almost falling on top of each other. Somewhere that feels like it should be, like near pristine. This is what a wild place could be like. The more time the Foundation spent there, the more they realize how much of an amazing place this is. We had this opportunity to sort of maybe make the biggest difference we had so far. This is where the science comes in, is that you can study somewhere like this, learn how it works, sort of try and get some kind of bearing on the system. I mean, it's so mind-boggling complex, we're never gonna know everything, but try and figure it out. How do the cogs fit together? And suddenly, I had this opportunity to build a whole new research program there on the sharks. My expertise, or the stuff I've done a lot through my own work, is tracking, which has only become possible through technology and satellites and fancy things like that. It's very basic information. But finding out where animals go, when, and the really hard part, but if you can, is why. So simply trying to figure that out, you can say, okay, well, actually, this protected area needs to be this size or this shape. And we're learning that Daros and St. Joseph are one of the places that are potentially critical to the recruitment, the repopulation of the broader area as a whole. Protecting key areas at key life stages can actually make a massive difference. Daros is tiny. You can walk around it in 1 hour. And right next to it is this atoll. An atoll is basically like a sunken island or volcano where you're left with a coastal rim with a lagoon inside. If the tide's low, you're stuck. You can't get in or out. Just a sort of very small, focused, but safe place. It's a nursery, the ideal spot for so many different things, including sharks. So this is an opportunity to sort of try and protect a breeding population or an area of critical habitat. But when they get to a certain age or size, most of them start to disperse in some way. Some just go from here to other parts of the Amara. Some go to Mahé and the wider plateau. Others actually roam the Indian Ocean. And hopefully, protecting a place like this and then other places alongside getting protected will feed back into that larger interconnected ecosystem. My children are the conduit through which I see the next generation, but it's that entire generation that inherits this Earth. Having kids and then seeing how they see the world and how they also know no different, how they see it now is how it will be for them. As much as we might try and tell them stories and show them how it may have been different, it's kind of, that's an experience they'll personally never have. And then the idea that that will continue to sort of, you know, just shift and creep through the generations is also pretty terrifying. It's a tremendous responsibility, but I've just got to try and do my best.
My dear brothers and sisters, citizens of the world, today we are gathered here to announce to our people and to the world the achievement of a great milestone, the legal designation of 1/3 of our ocean territory as a marine protected area.
It's been a very up and down, all over the place, long road, but if we can do that here, why can't it happen elsewhere? And if we can support people to bring about these changes all over the world, then a little bit at a time, we can seed that hope and inspiration to really try and make a difference at a global scale for sharks and reds.
This one's for the ocean, the mother of life. The sea's got horses that keep us safe, loving mother side. She's high.